Greetings, YouTubers. Here is the guy with the Swiss accent, with a new episode around sensors and microcontrollers. Lately, IKEA jumped on the IoT bandwagon and released a new line. It is called Tradfri Smart Lighting, and it is a direct competitor to Philips Hue. Tradfri is Danish and means wire-free. This line consists of controllers, lamps, and a gateway. As always, IKEA has an attractive price point for its devices. The cheapest set is around $20. Mine has a variable color temperature and costed around $30. Recently, I got these two devices from my local IKEA store. It is a Tradfri LED lamp and a controller. So let's hack it. Including a battery. Dangerous, but nicely looking actually. You see, this has a European E27, I think it's called, plug here. We can put it in somewhere. So let's test if it works and how it works. So this is magnetic here and can be taken off. So we open it up to mount the battery. And here we have the manual for even for people who cannot read. So we have to switch the lamp on and press this button for more than 10 seconds, and then it will be paired, I assume. So you still have to be able to read a little bit at least, that you can read the 5 centimeters or 2 inches. So let's try. Maybe I press it that I'm sure. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So that's for sure more than 10 seconds. Personally, I think it was already paired because I bought this as a kit together, and it is a nice, it's not a cold white, it's a warm white. So let's, it works. I can switch it on and switch it off. So we have basically, we have three functions: on, off, the color temperature, and the intensity. Now, of course, this is nice, but I want to use this with my MQTT stuff. So we have to hack this one here. So always, if you start to hack, you take out the battery, because otherwise you might be able to destroy somehow your device electrically, and this is not what we want. So let's continue on the bench. So one thing is interesting here. This is marked from the supplier, not from me. So it is some handmade stuff here. This is probably not yet a full production run. It's maybe still done with some manual work. But here we see we have one module here, which is soldered to a second module. And we also see here that we have some test points. And fortunately, I got some help. This is a German magazine, and they do some stuff with IoT and so on. And they also hacked this one here. So I have some information about the different pins. I do not need to hack them myself, but it's in German. I leave a link. Let's check if it still works, because otherwise it's useless. It still works. So fortunately I did not destroy it completely when I had to take it apart. So I connected now all wires according the make with the different colors. I was really glad that I had wires with all these colors here. So we have now a clear separation. Here we have ground, the test points here, all connected, and three pins of this module too. So let's do some measurements. So now everything is connected to the test points and to some other points here. And now we try to find out which one is which. I connect it to the orange, and here I have the oscilloscope. And if I press the on-off button, you see orange is on-off and it has negative logic. So if I press, it's zero. If I release it, it's 3 volt. So let's check the next one. So yellow is the left temperature. So we hacked the whole thing. We have now 3, 6, 8 wires and a WeMOS board which has a 3.3 volt output, so we can power also this one. And I will do something like that. I will print probably a round housing that I still can use it manually, and I will put in a WeMOS board here like that. So I have now to connect all these wires to this WeMOS board, and this is done with my third hand, which I built once in another video. So let's do it. I come back when it's done. Now everything is connected to this WeMOS, and I have already programming USB cable, and now I do not need a battery because I have this red wire connected to 3 volt, so I get the 3 volt from the WeMOS chip. So let's start with programming. Before I start to program, I have a table here with all the different pins and commands and colors and functions. The sketch is based on the PubSub client library and on the work of Marcus Alsace from Hamburg. I used his work but changed quite a lot in the area of pin handling. I also added a function which reads the physical buttons of the remote control and sends it via MQTT. This can be used to control other devices than the IKEA lamp. Here we have our definitions. The on-off function listens to command 0, and an orange wire connects it to pin D2 on the WeMOS. The darker listens to command 2, and a brown wire is connected to pin D5. In order to simplify the pin handling later on, I use an array. This array defines which pin belongs to which command. So, pin D2 belongs to command 0. This is why D2 is at the first place in the array. All other pins follow in the right order. If you go now to Setup, we find the MQTT specific functions. The only thing I had to add is the definition of the pins as input pins. Here you see that I do not need to define each pin separately. I just need a for loop. The loop section consists of 3 parts. In function read button, I check if a physical button is pressed on the remote control. If so, I publish a message with the topic IKEA/button and the command which fits this button. For non-experienced C++ programmers, I focus on the variable message for a moment. It is defined as an array of 50 characters. This means that we can stuff up to 50 characters in this variable. But C++ does not know how long this string really is. Only if we place a zero character at the end of our string, C++ can handle it. Our message is just one character long, so I add a zero character at the second place in the array. Now everything should work. Here I make sure that I do not send the same command twice. This part is called every 10 seconds and publishes a alive message to the IKEA/status topic. It can be used to check if something happened to our remote control. I could have used a delay to wait for the 10 seconds, but then the whole sketch would not work, because we frequently have to check if a button was pressed or if a message arrived. This is why we used this statement to write a non-blocking code. The rest of the loop is MQTT specific. But where do we get our messages with the commands? We did not find anything about that in the loop. This library uses the concept of callbacks. Here we defined a so-called callback function. This function is always called if a message arrives. Let's have a look at what this function does. It prints the message in serial monitor and decodes the command. I use human-readable ASCII characters as MQTT payload. So we have to convert these commands to a number from 0 to 5, because our commands are byte variables. This is easily done. If we subtract the ASCII 0 from our human-readable command, it is converted automatically into a byte variable. Simple. To test our sketch, I use my normal Mosquito MQTT broker running on a Raspberry Pi 0. We built it in video number 126. I also use the Node-RED flows, which we built in video number 127 and 128. First, I check if I get the commands and if the commands are executed by the remote control. And really, the lamp goes on and off if I send the command 0. And all other commands also work. Now I want to check if I can read the buttons. Again, success. So summarized. We were able to hack the newest IKEA IoT devices and connect them to a MQTT broker using a small VMOS module. We were also able to connect it to our home automation system without buying an expensive gateway. In this process, some of us learned some small programming tricks with arrays. And we learned why delay often has to be replaced by a non-blocking code. But was this hack a good idea? Yes and no. If we hack available hardware, we often run into the same problem. These devices do not give any machine-readable feedback about the current status. In manual mode, this is not necessary because you can have a look at them and you see if the lamp is on or off, for example. But if you want to automate them, your computer has to know the status of the device. Like with the brightness, you can just issue too many darker commands till you are very sure that the lamp is on the lowest level. Now you can start to count and you are pretty sure about what happens. This is completely different with the on and off function. Here your computer never knows if the lamp is really on or off. And this is not what I call a reliable system. It might work for a long time, but you are never sure. So this hack is just the first attempt, and good if you are still around to correct the status if needed. In the next hack, we have to dig one level deeper and hack the SIGBEE protocol. Here I hope that we will find absolute commands to switch the lamp really on or off. So stay tuned. I hope this video was useful or at least interesting for you. If true, then like. Bye.